fellows. I'm broadcasting. Use Gritto, radio friends. The soap that gives your hands that dishpan look. How will the old man know you've been working if your hands don't have that dishpan look? Put a box of Gritto in a glass of water. Then listen to it fizz. Dopes. Remember, Gritto spelled sideways is Otrigger. And now Gritto's own story of Sandra Sandpile, and here's Mud in Your Eye. Music.
I heard you on the wireless back in 52, lying awake intently tuning in on you. If I was young, it didn't stop you coming through.
Welcome to The Glowing Dial, the premiere edition of a new show here on Yesterday USA. I am your host, John, or Big John, Matthews, with my sidekick and co-host, Mr. Steve Archiver Bannock.
Hi there, everybody.
And, yes, we won the big vote, folks. We are the new show here on YUSA, although many of you may have heard us before. We've been on several times as a fill-in show, and... But now we're on permanently, and we are just tickled pink. And we're going to be playing some old-time radio for you here. Our opening, courtesy of the Three Stooges and the Buggles there. Bring that out. And we do want to say thank you to everybody who voted for us.
Indeed. Thank you all who supported us in this contest for the open spot on YUSA.
We're not going to mention any names here because I don't want to do favoritism or anything like that, but you know who you are who voted for us, and we thank you kindly. And I want to make a brief mention here. We're coming up on auction time here at Yesterday USA, the 1st of December. I think it's the day before Big Bill's birthday, too. You might want to think of that as well.
Yes, that's right.
Throw together an auction item. I mean, order some old-time radio shows. Those are the items that go really hot and really fast. And I'm doing a mega set of shows, putting together myself. So get an auction item together. Old-time radio shows, like I say, go the best. Send them out to Bill Bragg, Yesterday USA, 2001 Plymouth Rock, 75081. That's Richardson, Texas, 75081. Getting ahead of myself here.
Actually, all they need is the number. They really don't need Richardson, Texas. But, post office, it would help.
Well,
if they have
yes. So anyway, moving right along, we're going to bring you two programs here in this episode. We've got an episode of Jack Benny, my all-time favorite.
Always very good.
And an episode of The Strange Dr. Weird.
Always
so
very strange.
Stephen's going to introduce the first program for us here in a moment. As you know, our programs come to us via this wondrous console radio that we have here. We've rewired it. We got the idea from Fibber McGee, oddly enough. We rewired the radio and it now tunes in broadcasts from the past.
An amazing machine.
Yes, it knows what we want to hear and tunes it in for us. We don't question our friend the radio, we just know it works. So, Stephen, our first program is...
Okay, well, this is our first show, so why don't we stay on the theme of firsts and present the very first Jack Benny program.
Well...
Yes, Mr. Benny was on the radio for many years. 1932 started his beginning. And he went all the way to 1958.
Well, actually, 55. 55 to 58 was repeats.
Yes.
Of course, but...
He still had a regular slot all the way to 58.
And on TV
then he
for
was
many,
on
many
television
years.
Concurrently in, in the mid-50s, 55, 56.
Even earlier than
television.
That, I think he did some, too.
And he went well into the 60s on
after
television.
His radio show even ended, yes.
So he was on television for... radio and television for 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
Mm. So this show is May 2nd, 1932, the very first Jack Benny program. And I think you'll see some differences in this one than some of the other Jack Benny programs, because this was his first one. He had a lot of things
to come expect,
yet.
Yeah, don't expect Don and Dennis and Phil and all that stuff yet, but this is interesting. The quality is not the best, but you may have to strain a little bit, but still we want to present it because it's historically relevant. It's a rarity, and I'm glad I found it. Anyway, Stephen, if you'd lean over to the radio there
okay.
and
get in
click it on for us here. Hear the static come in there. So sit back, enjoy Jack Benny's first radio program, and we'll be back with the contest and how to get in touch with us in just a little bit.
Campaign of Ginger Ales presents a series of programs to advertise the new made-to-order Canada Dry, which you can now buy by the glass at drugstores and soda fountains. This series will feature George Olson and his music, Miss Ethel Cute, the star of many Broadway successes, and that suave comedian, dry humorist, and famous master of ceremonies, Jack Benny.
Thank you, Mr. Thorgerson. That's pretty good from a man who doesn't even know me. Ladies and gentlemen, this is Jack Benny talking and making my first appearance on the air professionally. By that I mean I'm finally getting paid, which of course will be a great relief to my creditors. I really don't know why I'm here. I'm supposed to be a sort of a master of ceremonies and tell you all the things that will happen, which would happen anyway. I must introduce the different artists who could easily introduce themselves and also talk about the Canada Dry made to order by the glass, which is a waste of time, as you know all about it. You drink it, like it, and don't want to hear about it. So, ladies and gentlemen, a master of ceremonies is really a fellow who is unemployed and gets paid for it. I think you will like the entertainment arranged for tonight, I hope. Of course, I haven't seen any of the program myself, but I've spoken to the artists individually. They seem to think it's awfully good. The first number will be a selection by George Olson and his orchestra. I think this, being our first program together, it is no more than fair that I have you meet Mr. Olson personally. He's really a very charming fellow and one of the few directors who comes to and from his work on roller skates. That's perhaps the silliest thing that I'll say all night, I think. I might add that Mr. Olson is very, very handsome. I told you, George, I'd get that in. But as long as we are both on the air, of course, I won't have to worry about that. Oh, George, come here. I want you to say hello to the folks.
Hello, everybody.
That was George Olson, ladies and gentlemen. He rehearsed that speech all week. You know, this is really all play with George. He doesn't have to work at all. I might say that Mr. Olson is one of the wealthiest conductors in America. You know what I mean. He owns his own car. Of course, the other boys are in debt, too. George, what kind of a car have you?
A Saxon.
A what?
A Saxon.
A Saxon, huh? Well, that was my fault for bringing it up at all. Is it a new one, is it?
Oh, yes, a very late model.
I see. Well, you must have been in this country a long time now, haven't you, Georgia?
Yes. Say, by the way, Jack, what kind of a car have you?
Me? I have a bicycle built for two. I mean, now, you can't go back any further than that, I think. Well, George, I think we ought to get started. What's the first number?
I beg your pardon, mademoiselle. It's a French number, Jack. Do you like French numbers?
Do I? Mon duck, mon duck.
Hollywood. pardon, mademoiselle.
That was swell. And I don't know, you look so important directing that orchestra, you know, with the baton in your hand. I don't know, there's something about all you fellas when you stand there waving that stick in the air. It's thrilling, you know. One thing I'd like to know, George, if the band didn't show up, what would you do with that stick?
Why, I'd throw it away and do what you're doing.
Always kidding. And now, ladies and gentlemen, may I present a young lady who is a star of many New York productions, Miss Ethel Chate. You will remember Miss Chate best in Whoopi playing opposite Eddie Cantor. Is it all right for me to mention Cantor's name here? Everybody else does. Ethel, come over and say hello.
Oh, hello.
Wasn't that clever? Oh, she does a lot of things like that. You'd be surprised. And Miss Chate is going to sing for us. She has a beautiful voice, too. She has a sort of a nervous soprano. You know what I mean? In fact, last week she had her nose lifted so she could be heard in Philadelphia. And, oh, by the way, here's a little news for you. Might interest you. Miss Chate is really Mrs. George Olson. Although I wouldn't go as far as to say that that's the reason she happens to be on this program. Nevertheless, she's Mrs. George Olson. Such a nice girl, too. I'm surprised that she's married to Olson. And now, Miss Chate will sing, I Found a $1 Million Baby. I still feel a little Frenchy tonight, Ethel, so it's mon duck to you, too.
$1 million baby in a 5 and 10 cent store. Ooh, ooh, ooh.
from the 5 and 10 cent store.
He was selling China.
What a charming couple. And, folks, I forgot to mention that Miss Jetay was assisted by Fran Fry. Of course, I'm lucky that I remember anything tonight. But you know, folks, all the time Miss Jetay was singing, I kept thinking of my girl. You know, I get so sentimental. I really have a girl. She lives in Newark, New Jersey. You know, the girl I go with when I'm in Newark? She's not what you'd call good-looking, exactly. In fact, she's quite homely, but then she can't stay in the house all the time. I imagine you folks have seen her pictures in different magazines. You know, she poses for the beauty ads entitled Before Taking. And she comes from a very fine family, although her father very often partakes of the forbidden beverage. It's all right for me to mention that, as they have no radio. In fact, her father drank everything in the United States and then went up north to drink Canada Dry. Boy, I'm glad I thought of that, Joe. You know, the one about Canada Dry? I'm really supposed to mention it occasionally. After all, I owe it to my sponsors, and they might be listening in. Seriously, though, do you realize, folks, that if you want a drink of Canada Dry, well, say just a glass. You don't have to buy it in a bottle. You can walk into any drugstore or soda fountain that has that big sign, Canada Dry, made to order, ask for a glass and get it. I know you always have it in your home in bottles, but isn't it nice to know that you don't have to wait until you get home to drink it? Gee, I thought I did that pretty well for a new salesman, eh? I suppose nobody will drink it now. And now, folks, a very stirring number called I Love a Parade with a vocal refrain by the Messrs. Fran Fry, Bobby Borger, and Bob Wright. Was I Love a Parade, ladies and gentlemen. It's the kind of a number that grips and thrills you, gives you that great feeling of patriotism, and makes you glad that you're an American. Personally, it didn't bother me very much because I took a nap while the boys were playing it. Now, folks, in case you've forgotten, this is Jack Benny again. You know, the Canada dry humorist. Say, I thought that was good. The Canada dry humorist. I made that up myself, huh?
It sounds like it.
That witty retort was by George Olson, ladies and gentlemen, proving again that he is still an orchestra leader. At that, George has a great sense of humor. Say, he told me a story the other day. Do you mind if I tell it, George? I'll give you credit for it, you know. It's really supposed to be true, too. It's about George's uncle, who had been ill for a long time. He had what you call labor poisoning. You know what I mean? He just couldn't stand working. So his doctor finally told him that he would have to get a lot of fresh air, do outside work, but not lift anything heavy. He told him that at no time was he to lift anything heavy. So his uncle got a job as a garbage man in Scotland. Funny, I never heard that one before, but the thing that kills me is Olson telling a Scotch story. I mean, because George, you know, is no centrist himself. In fact, he invited me to dinner the other night, much to his own surprise, and he paid the check with a $5 bill that was in his pocket so long that Lincoln's eyes were bloodshot. That's a fact. However, he will now favor us with that very popular song hit called Paradise. After all, why should his orchestra be an exception?
George Olson speaking. By this time, I know you're thoroughly bored listening to Jack Ben Brewer, well, our master of ceremonies and his alleged Canada dry humor and telling you all about made to order Canada dry. We also have a product to sell. It's music. And may we show you now just how we make music.
Listen, everyone, we're going to tell you how we all make music.
First, there's Wally. He sure plays some with two little sticks he beats on his drum. And that's how we make music. Now we have the boys with their violin. Their bows go back and forth when they begin. And the drums. Now the trumpets play loud and shrill, but when they get going, they'll give you a thrill. And the violin and the drums. The old trombone slides up and down. When he gets hot, he goes to town. And the trumpet, the violin, and the drum.
When we want to shiver, a quiver, or a groan, we call upon the boys with the saxophone. And the trombone, and the trumpet, and the violin, and the drum. Please, please, now, when we want some rhythm, where do we go? Why, it's old Bob Rice and his old banjo. And the saxophone, and the trombone, the trumpet, the violin, and the drum. Oh, the cow is now a little birdie. All right. Now, the next old fella can't be beat. You know him well. It's Piccolo Pete. And the banjo, and the saxophone, the trombone, the trumpet, the violin, and the drum. Okay, Ben Burney, if you like it. That's it. Now, we have the piano for cadences and such. All he needs is a very light touch. And the piccolo, and the banjo, and the saxophone, and the trombone, and the trumpet, and the violin, and the drum. So are you, so are you. Now, the old bass fiddle plays way down low. He has to get a Derrick to move his bow. And the piano, and the piccolo, and the banjo, and the saxophone, and the trombone, the trumpet, the violin, and the drum. Hey, please. Bass, piano, piccolo, banjo, saxophone, trombone, trumpet, violin. Now that's how we make music.
That was cute, George. I mean, babies will like it anyway, I think. And, that, ladies and gentlemen, is the way these boys make music. Now, if they could only play it. Mr. Olson will now play Come West, Little Girl, Come West. And I'm supposed to sing a chorus of this number. And do you know, folks, that 6 months ago, I couldn't sing a note. Really, I could not sing a note. But after taking 3 glasses every day of Canada Dry made-to-order ginger ale, I still am unable to sing and can't even sign a note. So the moral of this is drink that champagne of ginger ale, Canada Dry, and don't worry about signing notes. So for want of a better soloist, Miss Chute will sing, Come West, Little Girl, Come West. I'm going east.
I love to hear a cowboy sing like a cowboy sings when he's blue. Round the campfire on the range when his daily work is through. If I could hear a certain love song, what memories it would bring. I can't forget that love song the cowboys used to sing. The sun will set, the moon will rise, but I want to look in my baby's eyes. Come west, little girl, come west. The breeze will blow, the stars will peep, when I'm too lonesome to go to sleep. Come west, little girl, come west. Oh, don't be pining way, way down east. You know my love here for you will increase. I love the west, it's full of charm, but I rest best in my baby's arms. Come west, little girl, come west. The sun will set, the moon will rise, but I'm gonna look in my baby's eyes. Come west, little girl, come west. The breeze will blow, the stars will peep, but I'm too lonesome to go to sleep. Come west, little girl.
Hello, everybody. This is Kate Smith, Jack Benny talking. I mean, you see how nervous I am? I mean, not so much because I'm broadcasting, but I think all my relatives are listening in, and I don't want them to know that I'm working. Although I have an older brother that I'm quite fond of. I mean, we get along great. We sort of share everything together. I mean, what's mine is his, and what's his is his, you know. This has absolutely nothing to do with Canada Dry made to order. I keep getting entirely off the subject. But don't forget, folks, that you can walk into your neighborhood drugstore, or any drugstore. I mean, after all, I don't care what drugstore you walk into. I'm just the master of ceremonies here, that's all. I mean, if I'm going to have to worry about things like that, you know, I'll have my hands full. But go into any drugstore and order a glass, mind you. Not a bottle, but a glass of made-to-order Canada Dry ginger ale and stagger out. Isn't it funny, the things you can buy today in a drugstore? I went in for an aspirin the other day and came out with a new hat. I imagine the next number will be by George Olson. He's about to make his first appearance on this program. In fact, I'm lucky to get in here at all. This is called Drums in My Heart. And boys, try and finish this all together if you can. Here's the... Ladies and gentlemen, was the last number on our first program on the 2nd of May. Are you sleeping? I hope you'll be with us again Wednesday. In fact, I hope I'll be here Wednesday. George, so we all hope that we'll be here Wednesday. Well, good night then.
All aboard, away we go. Get that little lady on the train, boy. All aboard.
Gentlemen, we are concluding the first program in a new series sponsored by Canada Dry. The ginger ale now available made to order at drug stores and soda fountains, as well as in bottles. Canada Dry has presented Jack Benny, Ethel Chute, and George Olson and his music. The same group of artists will be with you at this time Wednesday evening. Drums in My Heart, from Through the Years, was played tonight with the special permission of the copyright owners. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
WJZ New York.
You're listening to Yesterday USA Radio Superstation. Hi, Big John and Steve back with you. Hope you enjoyed Jack Benny's first program there.
Boy, was that different.
Yes, and the click you heard is our machinery going through its paces. Folks, we've got a contest for you here, and it has to do with Jack Benny and the program we just heard.
No kidding.
Yes. We have three questions to ask you, folks, and if you answer all three questions correctly, you are going to win a tape, two episodes of The Jack Benny Show, and they're going to be from 1933. And neither of them will be the one you just heard, because we figure you're probably taping it at home anyway. We'll give you two other early episodes of Jack Benny. And the questions are as follows, Steve.
Okay, the first question, we'd like to know, what is Jack's given name?
Before he changed it to Jack Benny.
Right.
Number two?
Question number two. At Christmas time, Jack would always go into the department store and get an item for Don Wilson, but land up changing his mind.
He changed his mind several times throughout the show, driving Mel Blanc, who played the clerk, crazy. What were five of those items? Name five of the items. There were many of them.
Okay,
Steve?
And the third question. Over the years, Jack's had a number of sponsors. We'd just like to know what five of those were.
Yes, five of Jack's sponsors in the radio years from 1932 to 1958. 58. Even during the repeats, there was a different sponsor there. So, that having been said, Jack's real name, five gifts that Jack bought for Don, and five of Jack's sponsors. You can contact us via email at glowdial, G-L-O-D-I-A-L, at ix.netcom.com. And you may also write to us by snail mail at The Glowing Dial, P.O. Box 1524, Troy, Michigan, 48099-1524. And also, you may also leave us a message on our answering machine. And the number to call there, and it'll be Steve's machine you'll be getting
yes,
there.
You'll be getting my machine, area code 810-774-0112.
Very good. All right.
First person with the correct answer wins the prize.
Exactly.
And we'll announce that.
And we got just enough time here before we run over Bill's 55 minutes here to get in a strange Dr. Weird. And Steve, what is that?
Okay, the episode is titled The House Where Death Lived.
Ooh.
And it aired November 14th, 1944.
Okay.
And there's some scary stuff in Dr. Weird.
Ooh. Let's get it. Ooh, let's get a pencil off of you. Ooh. Anyway, it's time to go into that program, folks. So Steve, if you'll reach over and click onto the radio for us.
Okay, here we go again.
Okay. Warm it up here. There it is. So sit back and enjoy The Strange Dr. Weird, and we'll be back to say goodbye.
Adam Hatt presents The Strange Dr. Weird.
Good evening. Come in, won't you? What's the matter? Surely you're not nervous. Perhaps it will help calm you if I tell you a story I heard just the other day about a fortune that can be yours for the taking. All you have to do is go and get it. I call the story The House Where Death Lived.
Before you and I walk into the terrifying darkness of Dr. Weird's world, I think it's only fair on behalf of our sponsor to warn you that you'd better hurry if you want to see the latest fall line in up-to-the-minute Adam hats. Believe me, gentlemen, there's no better hat value anywhere in America than an Adam, worn by the famous, favorite of millions. There are thousands of Adam hat shops and authorized dealers from coast to coast. Stop in your nearest Adam hat shop tomorrow. Now, Dr. Weird.
My story, The House Where Death Lived, begins with two men crouching in the bushes, staring at a great lonely old mansion on top of a windswept hill.
Well, there it is. Spooky old joint.
Yeah, I don't like this job.
Hey, you're nuts. We couldn't ask for anything easier.
Yeah, but somehow that place gives me the creeps.
What do you mean? You're a detective, remember? A private dick here to protect the old boy.
Yeah, all right. Well, okay, let's get on inside and tell the old guy the detectives, Murphy and Smith, are here.
Now, wait a minute. In town, they said old man Crawford has a handyman who stays with him until after dark and then goes home. We're going to wait. I'd rather see the old man alone. You get me?
And so the two men waited in the gathering darkness outside until Frank the handyman left for the night. A few moments later, they banged the old bronze knocker on the front door of the ancient house.
Yes? Who is it?
Hey, what's that?
There must be a loudspeaker, of course.
Yeah, quite right. It is a loudspeaker. Are you Smith and Murphy, the detectives I sent for?
Yeah, we are.
Come in, please. You'll find me upstairs in my bedroom.
A minute later, old Joshua Crawford, sitting up in bed, surveyed his two visitors.
So you're my detectives. Which of you is Murphy and which of you is Smith?
I'm Sam Murphy and this is my partner, Bill Smith.
I'm glad you're here, very glad. I have work for you to do. In a vault in the cellar are jewels worth $250,000. And those jewels must be carefully guarded because they're bait for a trap I'm setting. A trap to catch seven murderers.
A trap to catch seven murderers?
Yes. 10 years ago, I was a wealthy man. I had a home on Long Island. And I had a daughter whom I loved. I had a son-in-law who was like a son to me. Then one night when I was away on business, a gang of thieves, seven of them, invaded my house. They were after the jewels I kept in a vault there. A vault to which only I knew the combination.
Say, do you mean to...
Shut up. Go on, Mr. Crawford.
Those seven men would not believe I was the only one who could open that vault. In the end, they killed my daughter and her husband.
Huh? I see. So you're that Crawford, huh?
Yes. I spent my entire fortune trying to trace the criminals. In the end, I succeeded.
Huh? You did?
Yes. I learned their names. They were called Big Jim Donovan, Trigger Thompson, Nicky Lavender, Tony Morton, Freddie Lake, Johnny Frisco, and Lefty Williams.
Tough bunch of monkeys.
How do you know they're guilty?
I know. I spent $1,000,000 to find out, and all my money was gone. All but the jewels for which my children were murdered, those I kept. I came here with them to bait a trap for murder.
You mean that...
Listen, I know where five of those seven men are. All except Johnny Frisco and Lefty Williams.
Yeah?
Now, if I say I know those men are guilty, even though I couldn't prove it in court, would you agree that they should be punished?
Absolutely, Mr. Crawford.
And if I can lure them here, would you help me execute them?
Execute them?
Yes. Help me to punish these men I've named... And the jewels in the vault are yours. Well, what do you say?
We're your men. Those rats deserve executing. And, Mr. Crawford, if you can get them inside this house, we'll be the executioners.
In just a moment, we'll return to our story and learn what happens to the murder trap set by old Joshua Crawford. Meantime, I believe Dr. Weird would welcome a brief escape from his shadowy world. Am I right, Doctor?
Yes. Yes, young man, you are right. All of us welcome the world of bright sunshine, far from the terrors of the night. I could say more.
You rest a moment, Doctor. I'll say more. How pleasant it is, gentlemen, during these bright days of fall sunshine, to step along knowing you're feeling right and looking right. And nothing gives that right look to a man like a really smart fall hat. Next time you're near an Adam hat store, stop for a minute and glance into the window. Some style, huh? Notice the variety of fall hats on display. Then step inside and try one on. You'll find the hat for you. Perfect fashion, perfect fit, no matter what shape head you have. See the latest Adam 5. Genuine hand block, fine all-fur felt hats. Up to the minute in style. Price, only $5. They're America's famous hat value. Other Adam hats are $3.45 to $10. Now, I see Dr. Weird is ready for the rest of tonight's play. Doctor?
Now to continue my little story of the house where death lived. Old Joshua Crawford, promising to tell the detectives more about his strange plan for vengeance in the morning, has dismissed them and fallen asleep. And Smith and Murphy are talking.
The idea of him trying to punish seven tough killers.
Yeah, there's something about this setup I don't like.
Ah, forget it. It's just luck he sent for us. Our good luck, see? Someday we'll run across Big Jim Donovan and one of the others and tell him about it. Oh, will they get a laugh?
Yeah, come to think of it, where is Big Jim and Trigger and Nicky these days? Keep our ears open. We ain't heard a word of them for months.
Yeah, they're smart and lying low, that's all. Now, can it, will you? We got something to do tonight. We got to prove we're good detectives by finding that vault those jewels are in. Come on, let's get going.
For an hour, the two men silently prowled the big house while old Joshua Crawford slept. Then, in a far corner of the cellar...
Hey, I found it. This door's a dummy, see?
Look,
here's the door of a vault right behind it.
Yeah, but look at it. It's like a bank vault. We'll never get it open.
Well, what are we going to do? Wait till tomorrow and see if we can get the old man to tell us the combination?
No. We'll get that combination from him tonight. Now, how about that combination, Mr. Crawford? Or shall I tell Sam to use that cigarette again?
No, I'll tell. 7 right, 13 left, 4 right, 10 left. And 0. 7 right, 13 left, 4 right,
10 right,
left,
then 0. Now, try it. That does it. He was telling the truth.
Yeah, a fat lot of good it'll do him. Come on, let's see what's inside.
Great. Gosh, it's a whole room in here.
Yeah, I'll say it is. The walls are solid stone, too. Look, here's a little table with a cash box on it.
Open it. Has it got the jewels in it?
I'll say it has. Look at them. Diamonds, rubies, emeralds. $250,000 worth.
Yeah, what's so funny?
Oh, what a laugh, that crazy old coot, saying he was going to use this ice for bait for 7 murderers. Now we got the bait.
I don't like it down here. Come on, let's put the ice in our pockets and get out of here.
Okay, I'm ready.
Huh? What is it?
That vault door. It's shut.
No, it can't be.
Well, it is. There's no way to open it from this side.
But it's got
to
be. Push against it. It's got to.
It's locked. We're locked in.
Yeah, but how could it be? Hey, how did it happen?
It happened when you lifted the cash box. An electric mechanism locked the vault door when the rats took the bait.
That's him. That's his voice.
Yes, by means of a loudspeaker. The whole house is wired with loudspeakers and microphones, you see. I've heard every word you uttered.
Listen, Mr. Crawford, you got us wrong. We wasn't really going to hurt you.
No,
you got to let us out of here.
To be sure. Push on the stone directly behind the cash box.
Yeah.
A hidden door will open.
A hidden door, yeah? Yeah, I got you. Come on, Bill. Here's the stone. Help me push it.
The wall's open. Here's the room on the other side.
I'll find it a much larger room in there, I assure you.
Come on, Bill. Must be a way out.
Yeah. Now the wall is closing behind us. Stop it with it.
No, it's too late.
Never mind. You won't be lonely. Look about you.
Huh?
You'll find many old friends to keep you company.
What's he talking about?
I don't know. Shine your light around.
Yeah. Look. 7 coffins. 7 coffins in a row on the floor.
Look inside them. You'll find your friends. The dry air has preserved them very well.
Big Jim Donovan's in this one.
And here's Trigger Thompson. Mickey Lavender. Tony Morton. Freddie Lee. These last two are wrecked.
Yes, they're for you unless you wish to confess and stand trial.
Confess? What do you mean, confess?
That you are Johnny Frisco and Lefty Williams. The last two of the 7 murderers I've been seeking for 10 years.
No, we're not.
It took my detectives a long time to find you. You were clever. From being crooks, you changed your names and became private detectives. But I found you at last. Now will you confess and stand trial?
No, you're wrong.
I gave the others the same chance, but each refused to confess. Look at them. They died a far more painful death than the electric chair. They died of starvation.
Okay, Mr. Crawford, we confess. I am Johnny Frisco. Bill is Lefty Williams.
Yes, yes.
Now come down and let us out. You gotta let us stand trial, you hear?
Yes.
You gotta.
I can't come down to let you out. You've tied me up. I can't get loose. You'll have to stay there until Frank arrives in the morning to set me loose. You'll have to stay there with your friend. I hope you won't be lonely.
Oh, no. No.
Unfortunately, poor old Mr. Crawford was unable to release his two victims from the trap he'd set for them. In the morning, he was found tied up and laughing, unable to speak a single intelligent word. He's in an asylum now, still laughing. Frisco and Lefty, they're still down in that secret room, their pockets stuffed with jewels. But by now, of course, they're probably quite dead. So if you want the jewels, you only have to go there and open the vault. And you have to go now. Too bad. But perhaps you'll drop in on me again soon. I'm always home. Just look for the house on the other side of the cemetery. The house of Dr. Weird.
That man will be back here again in a moment with a word about next week's scalp tingler. Meantime, it's not very far from scalp to hat. And having gone that far, perhaps I should remind you that this program is brought to you by Adam Hats, America's famous hatter. Seriously, gentlemen, I hope you'll take a look at the latest fall line of Adam Hats. They're top quality, identified by the famous Adam Crest. And their price, $3.45 to $10. Visit your Adam Hat Shop tomorrow. Now, that man, Dr. Weird.
I hope you'll drop in again next week. I want to tell you about a cat that had a human soul. Or at least acted as if it had. And so it... But the rest of the story will have to wait until your next visit. Good night.
Join us again next week at this same time for another visit with the strange Dr. Weird. The Strange Dr. Weird, directed by Jock McGregor, is presented by the makers of Adam Hats, the hats that are always topped in quality. This is Mutual.
Confidentially Yours with Arthur Hale will follow. Did the Herald Tribune sports page rank high with your man before he went to war? Well, chances are it still does. Keep him up to date by mailing the Overseas Sports Letter every Tuesday in the New York Herald Tribune. It is now 7:30 Eastern Wartime, WOR, New York.
You're listening to Yesterday USA Radio Superstation. Big John and Steve back with you to just in time to close out the show here. That was The Strange Dr. Weird, featuring Morris Tarplin, also known as The Mysterious Traveler. Matter of fact, a lot of these shows, I think, were remakes of Mysterious Traveler stories. Anyway, we're going to have to go, but we will see you in 2 weeks with a new episode here of The Glowing Dial.
Bye, folks.
In the meantime, please respond to our contest, and if we don't have a winner, we'll repeat the answers, or the questions, that is, on the next program. So until then, this is Big John Steve saying keep a positive thought, keep looking up, and we'll see you on the radio.